exercise follow the equator. We have a mobile body, later it will become a robot, moving in a 3D world which corresponds to a planet. The Earth, of course. We know the radius, and it is rotating along a vertical axis represented here in the figure in magenta. So the first question, we have to draw the Earth rotating, so in this direction, rotating, and also we have to represent a static body, so it looks like some kind of 3D triangle, tetrahedron. We also have to draw different frames, so R0 up to R3. So R0 is an inertial frame pointing towards the stars, so totally fixed in the world, you can assume. Then R1 is fixed with respect to the Earth, so it means that the x-axis will point, as we see here, to a point which corresponds to the meridian, a given meridian, meridian zero or meridian of Greenwich. And the speed of the Earth is known, so the frame R1 will turn with the Earth. We also have a mobile body, so the robot, and in this robot we will attach a navigation frame, so going to north, east, and to the sky. And the last frame is the frame of the robot, where X corresponds to the main axis of the robot going forward, and also the K axis will go at the bottom of the robot. So recall the convention, red RGB, so red, green and blue, this order means X, Y and Z. I will start with this Python program. This Python program, we use rublib library, which contains a lot of small functions related to robotics, to this course. The first thing, I will have to draw to declare a figure, so it is this function, axis 3D, with x minus, so this corresponds to x max, y min, y max, and so on. This one is z max. So I declare some frame with this corresponds to the radius of the Earth, so it corresponds here to 10 meters as asked in the exercise, and my body will be the position of the body will correspond, so in the world I will have here my frame x, y and z. I will have something like here the Earth, and I will have here somebody, the body, the robot. So this robot will correspond, will have a position P in this absolute frame, in the inertial frame, and also the orientation will be given by a matrix R3. So here in the program I will draw the axis corresponding to this, so x, y and z. That's why here, since the orientation is the canonical one, I have here the identity matrix. This one is just to increase or decrease the size of the arrows, just for graphic reasons. Then I draw first the axis here. Then this statement is to draw the Earth, and the last one here, this one, is to draw the body. So I switch to Python. I have my program, I run it, and I obtain the Earth, the frame, and the body. So in red corresponds to X, green Y, and Z for the blue. The body is painted blue, and we can see here the shadow. The magenta point here is the reference. It is on the equator, but also on the meridian zero. So this red arrow points directly towards this reference point. The Earth has to rotate. So I will declare a variable psi Earth correspond to the speed of the rotation rate of the Earth will be taken as given in the exercise at 0.2 radian per second, and I will have to perform a for loop for the simulation to see the Earth moving. I will have my frame R0 corresponding to the fixed frame, and the other one I will represent blue here, the same here, but it will rotate like this, so that the Greenwich meridian will the new x-axis of R1 will point toward this meridian, and this meridian will turn with the Earth. So here is the north, and here the south. So here for my loop, I have to declare a sampling time dt. So dt is taken as 0.05, so it should be very small, not too small, otherwise the speed will not be enough high for the simulation. Then my rotational omega vector, omega for the Earth, omega e, in the frame 0 will be taken as omega e, which correspond only to the k direction, so 0, 0 here, and here psi dot e. And this one is declared here. Then I have some similarities between the previous program here. So this one is here. So this one is here. I declare here the position for my body. So my body is here, for instance, and it has a position of the center and an orientation given by the matrix R3. My loop is here. So at each iteration, I clear the picture, otherwise I will have a superposition of all my picture. I compute R1, which is a rotating frame, so this one, represented blue here, here. Then again, I will draw the axis corresponding to the inertial frame here. I will draw the Earth gray here, as it was the case before, here. And again, I will draw the robot here. It was also the case here. So I have mainly added the loop and the rotational information about how the Earth is rotating. So if I do this, I have here my Earth rotating with my inertial frame, and now I will have to draw R1, R2, R3, but I will try to avoid the superposition by adding a small shift, otherwise I will not see anything. We can see here the reference point turning with the Earth. Note also that many procedures such as draw the Earth are given in the Roblib library. To draw all my frames, I need to recall what is a latitude and longitude, here given by Lx and Ly in this picture. And the frame is given in the lesson, in the book, and the rotation matrix associated to the longitude Lx and the latitude Ly is given by this matrix, and it can be easily be defined by the Euler matrix by multiplying Euler matrix corresponding to phi theta psi. So here it's psi equal to Lx, which can be understandable geometrically. And here it is transpose of another Euler matrix. So let me explain the program that draw these axes. It is exactly the same as the previous one with very small modification. So the previous one was given here. So I still use Roblib here and here. This has not changed. So definition of some constant. The initialization I take for the body exactly the same. I will not use it here, except to define my matrix R3 and R2 also. Here the rotation vector to draw my picture. They are exactly the same. My loop the same, except I change the maximum time. I define R1 as previously, and this corresponds to the definition using Euler matrix, where here I extract from the position P of my body, so it has position P. I extract in the inertial frame the latitude and the longitude, and here I multiply by the Euler matrix and it transpose here as previously seen in the book. Then once I have all my matrices, I still draw the inertial frame here. I still draw the rotating frame with associated to the Earth, so the Earth frame. I still draw my robot here and here, but moreover, I will draw these two frames corresponding to R2. So the Earth is like this, to R2, so like this, so K, east and north, okay, given, so it corresponds to R2, and also I added the frame corresponding to the body, so with X, Y and Z on the top, which corresponds as for the orientation R3 given here corresponding to the orientation of my body. So in this program I have initialized the orientation for my body using the Euler angles corresponding to phi, theta and psi. But later, I will try to avoid the use of this Euler angle due to some singularities we could have nearer to the pole. I switch to Python. I run the program, and I see here my two frames, four frames, with the body with not changing, the inertial frame given here with the north, east, and sky, the inertial frame, and here the Earth frame pointing towards the reference point of the Earth. So let me recall that we had the inertial frame R0, R0 corresponding to the initial frame and the matrix R0 equal identity in R3. We had another frame R1, the origin of which should be here but has been represented here for graphical reasons. R1, the associated matrix, is given by the Euler matrix with the angles phi theta equal to 0 and psi corresponding to the derivative of the rotational speed times t. We also add R2, so R2 corresponds to this one, the frame R2, which is called the navigation frame, so north, east, and sky, which was given by the product of two Euler matrices, 0, 0, and arctangent 2, of P2, P1, where P corresponds to the position of the center in the initial frame, multiply by the transpose of the Euler matrix of two angles as given in the course, minus P divided by 2 arc sine of P3 divided by the norm of P, and the last angle is minus P divided by 2. Okay, so it was for the first question. Now we need to provide a kinematic state equation for the body. So the body is moving. The state variables, as seen in the course, are the position, the orientation, or equivalently the Euler angles, and also the speed. So when I put a 3 here, it means that it is expressed in the frame of the body. Why it is the case? Because most of the time when we measure the orientation, it is by the body itself, by sensors that are in the body, and they are expressed in the frame of the body. So P is the position of the body, of course, in the inertial frame. R3 is the orientation of the body, and V3 its speed when the observer is fixed with respect to the stars. But it is expressed in R3. So in the kinematic model, as we have seen in the lesson, the inputs are the rotation, the value given by the gyrometers, or the vector of rotation, the rotation vector of the body, and the acceleration. So what we have to do now is to propose a simulation where with the Earth rotating and the body is moving in the space, and the gravity, which has to be taken into account, is given as given by the attraction rule law of Newton, and which is recalled here. So when we are at the surface of the Earth, the gravity is oriented to the center, but as is equal to 9.81. Okay. So in the course, the kinematic model which has been given was this one. The input were omega r. It was also the acceleration here, so omega r measured. So it is convenient to take this model because often these quantities are given by some inertial sensors. So now, instead of taking the Euler angle, it is equivalent from phi, theta, and psi, we can get the rotational matrix R, which has been called in our context R3. So it is a function, so here I would have R3, and so on. So in this case, this equation is not needed anymore and should be replaced by an equation on R3, where I have something like R3 dot is equal to something depending on R3 and other state variable. So I know from the lesson that I have some relation like this, where R dot R transpose equal to the adjoint of omega, but omega is given in the inertial frame. Okay. I have also another relation where I commute these two and I obtain that R transpose R dot is equal to the adjoint of R transpose omega 0, or in our context, R corresponds to R3, and this one corresponds to omega expressed in the frame number 3, which is the one which is the frame of the body I am interested with. So it means that this equation, which does not exist anymore, can be replaced by R dot 3 equal to R3 multiply by the adjoint of omega R that I can rewrite like omega like this. So this is a matrix corresponding to the operator which is equal to adjoint of omega 3. So often this matrix I can write it like this. So the second equation will be this one, omega 3 right now. So the state variable, so with this new system, the input are the same, but the state variables are P, R3, VR, and I can perform an integration using an Euler method, but better, a Runge-Kutta integration method. So with respect to the previous program, I added the gravity here, G of P, which is a Newtonian gravity with the attraction of bodies. I also added the function here for F kinematic here, where I compute dp, dr3, dv3 corresponding to this quantity. The input are the state variable here, but also the inputs which correspond to the acceleration and also the rotation vector inside the body frame. I compute inside the loop at this level, I compute if kinematic, and if you want it correspond to x dot equal f of x and u, where u correspond to this and the state correspond to this. But recall that since the matrix is of dimension 9, I have some redundancy, where it means that with Euler angles or quaternion, the computation would be faster. So this here are the derivative, and I use at this level an Euler integration method, which is not the best one in this context, to compute the new P R3 and V3 at time t plus dt. So here I stopped at 1.5 seconds in my context, and I will start now my simulation. So this is my program. I start it, so I put a small dt in order to see things moving. Up, so we see here the body turning like this, and it is attracted by the center of the Earth, like a satellite. And we'll see that it takes some energy and comes back here, which is quite normal when we use Euler integration method. The body has some tendency to take energy, but the behavior is very similar to what we could have for a satellite. So we have seen that the body were turning, rotating, and this is due to the fact that here I put for W3 a rotation, but I put no acceleration, so I have only the effect of the attraction onto the Earth. So we have provided the kinematic state equation for a given field, gravity field corresponding to the Newton attraction. Now it will be different. The planet is assumed to be made of water, and the body is now a robot, an underwater robot. So it will not behave anymore like a satellite. It has propellers or other actuators to move inside the water. The gravity, since we are inside the Earth, when we go to the center, the gravity will not tend to infinity as it was the case before, but it will converge to zero. So the behavior is different. The gravity field is now proportional to P, to the norm of P. If I am at the surface of the Earth, then the gravity is still equal to 9.81. So what will happen? The water will drag the robot, and the robot will tend to move with the water. Okay, and there is also some friction forces, tangential or in rotation. And then we will assume here that the robot has the same density as the fluid. So it will tend to be static with respect to the fluid, and it corresponds to some Archimedes buoyant forces. So now we have forces, we have masses, and it will not tend to build a kinematic state equation now, but more a dynamical model. That's what we'll do now. So of course we'll have new inputs corresponding to acceleration provided by the propellers, and also some tangential acceleration. So the acceleration comes from propellers, but also can come from reaction wheels or rudders or any kind of actuators. We have to first to find a dynamical model, and of course I will use the kinematical one, and then I will have to propose a simulation of my body or my robot. So I will start with my kinemical model given here. So this one corresponds to the kinemical model. I have as a state variable P the Euler angle or the rotation matrix and V3. So it means that here the dimension is 3 plus 3 plus 3 corresponds to 9. Now when I have a body in the space like this, the state should correspond to the degree of freedom, so it means P and phi theta and C, or equivalently the rotation matrix R, and also the derivative, so it could be corresponds to P dot or phi dot, psi dot, theta dot, or equivalently here I have taken for the first one V dot 3, which corresponds to this, but I still need other something in memory corresponding to the derivative of the Euler angle. And in fact, it corresponds to omega 3, the one which is given as an input. So in front of the kinematic block here, I will compute the value of the gyro and the accelerometers by rules where the only state variable will be omega 3. So in fact, the whole system, like this, will have as an input u, the acceleration given by my actuators, the angular acceleration also given by my actuators, and the output will correspond to one state variable and something else which corresponds to A3. So I will have only one differential equation corresponding to the first one. So what about omega dot 3? So omega dot 3, I will have to fill here, corresponds to first the friction. So the friction, it means that when a body is moving inside the water, it will slow down, and I will have something like, I can give a model like this, minus omega 3. Normally it's a square, and the square of omega 3 and not omega 3 itself, but since it is a fluid friction. But here, for simplicity, I will take this one. I have also some coefficient in front of it, but here I will assume this coefficient is equal to 1. And also, due to the fact that the liquid is moving, if my body is inside, the friction will make the body or the robot tend to have the same rotational speed as the Earth. So I will put here omega Earth. I will put it in the frame R3, and this corresponds to a first order system where omega 3 will tend to a value corresponding to the rotation of the Earth. So this corresponds to the friction term. Due to the friction on the water, my body will tend to behave as the water around itself. So here I will put minus omega 3 plus R3 omega e. So this one is known and it is constant. And also I will have to add the acceleration in rotation corresponding to the result of the actuator. So I will call it here U omega 3 and it corresponds to an input of my system. This one. So plus U omega 3. Okay, so now I will have to do something similar with the acceleration. What about A3? So I will have three different terms. The first one will correspond to the friction, so the water friction. The water will tend to decelerate my body. I will have also the Archimede forces or acceleration plus also the actuators. So I will try to explain how this can be. So what about the friction? The friction will be the first one, the second one, and the third one. So the friction will generate an acceleration, which slow down the robot. As a first approximation, as before, we may assume that the acceleration is proportional to the speed difference between the robot and the fluid around it. So the speed of the fluid is given. So the speed V, velocity of the fluid, is given by the rotation vector of the Earth with product with P, because it is just near to the robot and P is the position of the robot. So it is the speed of the fluid. And we get an acceleration which may be approximated by the difference of the speed of the fluid and the robot itself. So I have to put everything in the same frame. So here I can say that the first term here corresponds to the difference. So I put it this one R3 time multiply by VF. So multiply by omega E product with V minus V3. This is the first. Now so one. Now what about two? The acceleration, so I have my body which is here. And the fluid around it. The fluid has an acceleration. Okay. And the acceleration, since the speed of the fluid is Vf, the acceleration of the fluid is V dot F. So I compute V dot F. The acceleration of the fluid corresponds to omega I vector P dot plus omega I dot vector P. But since this one does not change, omega I does not change, this is zero. Okay. And this P dot, it is of course not exactly P dot, it should be, since I consider the fluid, it is VF, in fact. So I will have here omega E vector VF. And now I know from the previous equation that it is equal to omega I vector product omega I vector product P. Okay, so if the robot is static, with respect to the fluid, and if it has the same density as the fluid, then it will behave as the fluid. So it will have the acceleration v dot f. And this corresponds to the result of the Archimedes forces. So due to I have to put everything in the reference frame, and also what I will measure, because recall that what I want to generate for A3 is what I measure, I will get here. I will get A3 R3 transpose, so it corresponds to this one. So what I have computed, omega e vector omega e vector product p minus j of p. And the last one, this one, corresponds plus u a 3, so the acceleration due to the propellers. That's what I have to take this part, and this part should be here. Okay, so now I can program this. And compare to the previous one. So the last program was on the left and the new one on the right. So what did I change? First, the gravity has changed. The kinematical model is the same since I have added a block before. Here, the dynamical model is new. It was not existing before. So the dynamical model uses somewhere the kinematical model because it composed of the first block here followed by the kinematical model. First, the state of the system X is of dimension 12, and recall that it corresponds to P, to the rotation R3, to the speed V3, and to the rotational vector V3, so expressed in the frame of the robot. So I extract here from my state vector X the information I need. At this level, I compute the derivative of omega 3 as previously described, where I have the friction plus the acceleration due to the propellers. Then the expression for A3 was the one I have computed before. So this one, A0, corresponds to omega e vector product. So it is a matrix. Then I stack all of them to build x dot that will be used by the integration method. So what I can recognize here, this corresponds to this. Okay, and this here corresponds to this. Okay. So what else? What did I change? Previously, I used Euler method for the integration. When I have friction, I can say that the Euler method behaves quite well. But when I have a conservative system, such as the satellites, and in general, it is better to use a Runge-Kutta method. So that's what I do here. That's why it is important to cast everything into a single vector x containing all my state variables, so that I can use the Runge-Kutta formula, which call several times f dynamic. Again, I have to extract from x all my state variables in order to be able to do my drawing. I run the program, and I can see after some initialization. So I turn with the mouse wheel, and we can see that the body becomes static with respect to the planet. So here in our simulation, we have the feeling that it is outside the liquid, but I am just a representation. Everywhere it is a liquid. Okay, everywhere. So the simulation has stopped. So the attraction with respect to the center is proportional to the distance. Everything, everywhere, it is a liquid. Last question. Now we have to find a model for the robot, which will be described by a Dubbins-like model. So a Dubbins-like model means that we cannot control the speed or the acceleration, and we are only allowed to control the rotation. So here we assume that we have a single propeller, so we push the robot forward without any possibility to control the speed, and it is what we have for classical Dubbins car on a 2D plane. But here it's three-dimensional. That's why the inputs will not be able to choose it, will correspond to 1 because we go forward, and 0 because we don't move laterally, and 0 here because we don't move respect to Z, the local Z of my robot. So the robot can choose its rotation using rudders, jet pumps, inertial wheels, whatever. But here we'll directly assume that we have a low level system that allow me to control with a joystick or what to control the rotational speed. So it will be the input of my system. What I have to do is to find a controller such that the robot goes to east along the equator. Of course, since I am in the planet, it is very convenient to use the rotational matrix and not Euler angle, since I have no singularities, even near to the poles. This is the equator here, and I want to follow the equator. I am here. It's my inertial frame. And here it is the frame R3, the frame of my robot. So first I notice that since I want to go this direction, if I follow the navigation frame, so navigation frame is I put it here, but it should be here, so it is north, east, and here it corresponds to K, and here to G. If I follow R2, then if my robot is here, I will go to east. But I want also to be attracted like this to the equator. So I have a variable which I call, so the position is P, and P is equal to, let's say, px, py, pz. If pz is positive, then it means that I am above the equator. So in this case, I want the frame to follow is the inertial is R2, so the inertial frame, but I want to rotate so that it will be attracted by the equator. So the method I use is very similar to the potential field approach. To each P, I associate a frame I want to follow of P. So I will call it R4. So if I am here, for instance, the frame will be like this, okay, to be attracted by this, and there was a vector, but here like this, and so on. So R4 will be equal, so it depends of P, is equal to R2 plus a deformation which make me attracted, and this one will correspond to a rotation, so multiplied by a rotation, and the rotation will correspond to a direction I want to turn toward. So it means that I will multiply by the exponential of a vector, the direction I want to turn to, and this vector will be, let's say, a vector with the, it will be the adjoint of the vector. So what happened about the latitude, so with respect to x, I don't want, I cannot control the speed of the robot. So it means that the, if it is a robot, I can only go forward like this, but I can influence the rotation, and here it is the rotation I want. The rotation, so zero here, because I don't want to take any rolls. Here, to be attracted by the equator, I will put something related to PZ, but with a saturation. So that's why classically we use tangent hyperbolic for the saturation. It means that if I am far, if P is far to the equator, then I will have a direction which is similar to 1 radian. And not 10 radians or something like this, which would correspond to a very bad behavior. And here also, when I am, if here I have the Earth, if I am far to the Earth, for instance, like this, and even if this is the equator, if I am far, I want to be attracted by the Earth because I want to be at the surface of the Earth, as asked by this exercise. If I am near to the center, I want to go on the other direction. So it means I want to have the norm of P minus the radius of the Earth. I want this to be equal to zero. So it corresponds to an error, and I will, as I've done here, PZ was also an error. I want this error converge to zero with a saturation for the same reason as before. That's why here I take the tangent hyperbolic of P minus rho T. It corresponds to a proportional control, because it is proportional to the error with a saturation, which is quite classical, this kind of control in robotics, proportional plus some saturation. This corresponds to the vector I want to orientate my vehicle. This corresponds to the corresponding rotation. I multiply by R2 because if I'm happy, the error is equal to 0, and then the direction I want to follow will correspond to R2. So if the error is 0, it means that I am here, and of course I will follow R2, which corresponds to this direction. My robot has a frame, so X, Y, and Z, corresponding to R3. But my robot wants to follow a field, want to have a rotation matrix, which is not this one, it's another one. So let's say this one, I put it here, one, for instance, this one, which corresponds to R4, which is given here. So to move from this R3 to R4, I need some kind of interpolation, and I want to turn around a vector which will correspond to U omega 3, so expressed in the frame 3, that will feed my my dynamical system. And this is also the output of the controller. So U for the U omega 3 will be given by I will take R34, so to go to the frame 3 to the frame where I want, which depends on P, and I will take the logarithm of this, and the logarithm will correspond to the vector on which I want to which corresponds, it will correspond to a matrix, but it will correspond to the adjunct of a vector I want to turn around. So I will take here the adjoint minus 1, and in this case this becomes a vector. Now I will have to perform due to the fact that I want to put it in the R3 space, I will have to multiply by A4, and because it was expressed in the frame R4, so I will have to do the reverse way, R3 transpose, and this will correspond to the rotation vector I want to make my robot going from R3 to R4. Compared to the previous program, this one and this one are the same. This one and this one also. The dynamical model is also the same. The main program, what changed? U here was equal to 0 in the previous, now it uses the control function which is given here. So everything that changed in this program corresponds to what I have in the control procedure, and I call it here to feed the dynamical model. Okay, so now I remove this one. Okay, so in my control program I can recognize R3, R4 which was computed here, I recognize here the tangent hyperbolic which was given here. With some coefficients, I put for a good behavior 20 to be well attracted toward the towards the equator. So it corresponds to gain, to some gain I have to tune by hand. Here I recognize the acceleration. I cannot choose in, since it is an acceleration going forward. And the formula I have here corresponds to this formula. So it computes the rotation vector I need to turn around in order to go from R3, with so the my frame, to the frame where I want to fit with. I take the Python program, I run it, and I can see that my robot is going towards the equator even if the Earth is turning, rotating. If I see from above, I can observe that the robot has some problem to join exactly, to reach exactly the equator. It is at few meters further. So it is due to the fact that since it turns faster than the Earth, the archimical so the centrifugal force will be larger than the one of the surrounding fluid. Okay, so here I have the result of few simulation. The first part here is the initialization, where here it takes some time to reach the equator. Here I have another view where I can see some oscillation at the beginning due to fact to the fact that I have no derivative gains, but it and if I see from above, so here it corresponds to the North Pole. In red it is always the equator, and I can see that I will not converge to the equator. I need some kind of integral effect to have this.